How's it going, guys? It's your boy McAtee here, and today I'm happy to be back with another tutorial. So I was watching Travis Scott's new music video and I was like, damn, that's such a cool shot. And then I was like, damn, am I gonna be able to pull that off? And I was like, damn, so many dams. So I decided to give it a try, and I think I found a way of replicating how to create a similar type effect in After Effects and Cinema 4D. I'm gonna give this effect an 8 out of 10 Adobe crashes. First step is to get out there and film your footage. I'm using a green screen to key out my subject. It'd probably be better to use a blue screen, but you know, broke filmmaker life. If you guys want some more tips about green screening, check out my previous video where I highlight some tips. I made a mini plank kind of thing that my subject could walk across. I made sure to put some green fabric on top of it so it can be keyed out later. Also, a pro tip is use a vacuum or a garden blower to get some realistic wind movement. It actually helps sell the effect immensely, so I'd really recommend you do this. In order to light the subject, I kind of had to make do with what I had. Ideally, you'd probably want like a really big, soft overhead light to replicate the moon, but I only had two lights, which I just bounced off two white pieces of fabric, and that was good enough to light the green screen and my subject. Now, I also used my slider to create a little bit of movement. It's not as drastic as the actual music video, but it's enough to kind of sell the effect. For the next step, we have to jump in a Cinema 4D. Ideally, I'd rather do the whole thing in After Effects, but it's pretty hard to actually find a beam image that you can put your subjects onto, so we have to kind of create it from scratch. Let me know if you guys thought it was a real beam in the description below. Now that you look back on it, you probably notice that it's not a real beam, but yeah, maybe fooled you. First up by creating a new project in Cinema 4D. Go into one of the side views and start to draw out a capital I shape with the spline tools. Handy tip is to make sure you change the reference from object to world. Go back into your main view and drop your spline object into an extrude modifier, and now you have a beam. Well done. Now, depending on your camera angle, you may want to add in a concrete pillar like I did. That's actually really easy to do, so I'll show you how to do that now. First step, add a cube and change the size. Add another cube, but this time make it smaller in length and larger in width. Make sure you fill out the edges in the cube settings. We can now duplicate the cube a couple of times. You'll see why we do this in a little bit. I also modeled some connection pieces, which are just a single cube modified, and some nuts, which I just made out of hexagons. You don't really see it that well, but it does the job. Now we can jump into Octane or the renderer of your choice. You can use the standard renderer, but I'd recommend that you try and invest in a physical based renderer or something like that. For the textures, I used a polygon texture. I'd really recommend Polygon. It's actually a great website. Subscriptions start at $12 and you can get like, I don't know, 10 or 12 textures and some HDRIs or whatever you choose. It's not a promotion for Polygon, but I just really enjoy their website and what they offer. If you want to know more information about node-based texturing, I'd recommend you go watch the video I'm about to link in the description. I think it deserves its whole own video to talk about materials and how that works. So go spend some time doing that. I basically combined a couple of the polygon textures using some displacement maps as surface imperfections and just made it kind of look all messy and grotty. Grotty, I'm very Australian if you can't tell. Step 3, camera tracking. Now it's time to actually track our footage in Cinema 4D so we can add the modeled beam into the right position. Again, I'm going to link a more in-depth tutorial on camera tracking because it's a whole another area on its own, but I'm going to give you a quick rundown of what I did. Open motion tracker. Select your footage. In 2D tracker, select auto track. Wait for it to finish. After that's done, go into 3D solver, input your camera's information if you have it, and press run 3D solver. You should now have a camera and a bunch of tracking markers. From there, we can right click and then click planar constraint. Line the 3 points with 3 tracking markers on a floor or wall. Now open both of your Cinema 4D files and add the beam into your track footage. All you have to do is just line your modeled beam with the main character until it looks right. For lighting, I'd recommend that you use a HDRI or some octane lights to replicate whereabouts you put the light in the real world. This HDRI is also from Polygon, but you can grab some free HDRIs from HDRI Heaven or Haven. All that's left to do now is just render the beam. First, turn off your projection so you don't have that annoying person in the way. Then you can go into your settings and make sure that you check your alpha settings are on. If you're using Octane, you have to do this in both the save setting and the Octane settings. For the actual render settings, I'm also going to link another video in the description below that goes into more options and what's right for your computer. Here's a quick pro tip that I recommend you guys use. Now, if you do a quick key of your subject, you can actually place it on a plane in Cinema 4D and replicate what it should look like when you finish rendering. To do this, all you have to do is just create a plane, make it perpendicular to your camera. Place it as a subject or a child of your camera, create a new Cinema 4D material. In Luminance, select the first frame of your keyed subject. Click on the text button and go into animation. Select the number of frames and the frame rate. Click back on the Luminance tab and click and drag the current texture file to the Alpha tab. Check Image Alpha and Soft. The last thing to do is go into your Editor tab and select Animate Preview. You should now have a video that plays on top of your footage and it gives you a kind of idea of what it's going to look like. Step 4, compositing. Now we can finally head into After Effects, even though this is a After Effects tutorial. We haven't really done much in After Effects just yet. I don't know what's dancing. Import your footage and create a new comp. Since I rendered my camera tracking scene as a PNG sequence, I have to reset the frame rate. To do this, right click on the sequence and click Interpret Footage. Then you can choose your frame rate. This was an absolute pain in my butt. I didn't know how to do this, so keep this in mind. We can now do one of the most tedious jobs you can ever do in After Effects, which is rotoscoping and keying. I'm gonna link some videos in the description, a lot of videos that I'm linking today that goes into more information about green screening and rotoscoping and how you can do those properly. Now, so far we should have a motion track beam and our character walking on it, which is pretty cool. Now, the last step is to create the background or buildings. And to do this, we're actually gonna use a very simple projection mapping technique in After Effects, or projection mapping type thing. First, you need to find a high quality image. I used this image of Pixel. We now have to cut the image up into foreground objects and background objects. We do this in Photoshop using layer masks and the stamp tool. If you really want to go the extra mile, you can actually animate some things in the background. For example, I animated these cars moving. It just gives it a little bit more realism, but it takes a lot of time. I'm also going to link the image I use below so you guys can use it and you don't have to cut everything out. Once we have cut up our image, we can jump back into After Effects and then import our photos into a new folder. Now we actually have to track our footage again to create a realistic camera and a realistic movement. Now this is really simple to do. All you have to do is select 3D camera tracker and apply it to your footage. Once we have our tracking markers, we can select a couple, click create camera, and create a plane also. Now we should have a camera that matches the exact same movements of our Cinema 4D camera, and that's pretty dope. Simply import your images, make them a 3D object layer, and then reset the rotation and position. You want to put the foreground objects closer to the camera and the background objects further away from the camera. If we move our background images further away, you'll notice they get smaller. To counter this, we have to turn up the scale. Eye it up and you should have something like this. It's only a very subtle movement, but it helps sell the effect a lot. All that's left to do is put it all together. I also added a corner pin effect to the background composition in order to kind of readjust the camera angle so it looks a bit better with how I originally shot it. Step 5. The last and final steps are to color correct, color grade, and do the audio. We can now attempt to match the blacks, the whites, and the overall saturation until it kind of looks like it belongs there. In order to color grade our overall product, we need to create a new adjustment layer and add Lumetri color to that as well. Add a light and adjust it to the way it makes you feel most happy. Last step is to add some audio, so chuck in some city sounds, chuck in some wind, and you know, chuck in some footsteps if that's what you want. Thanks for making it to the end of the video, guys. I hope you guys really did like it. If you learned some new stuff or you found this video interesting, make sure to leave a comment. You don't have to. Do whatever makes you feel happy or whatever floats your boat. And yeah, don't forget to learn, create, and share. And I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace.